After carrying out the regression analysis, we obtain a bunch of numbers and we are able to write down the linear equation model. A very important question we like to ask is how good this model is. This is model diagnostics. In general, there are four methods to evaluate our model. First, ANOVA. Second, R-squared. Third, standard error of estimate. And the very last one, residual analysis. First, let's take a look at ANOVA. For a different type of ANOVA that compares population means, in one of the earlier videos, please click on the linked video in the upper right corner of this screen. In ANOVA for regression, the analysis of variance, we divide the total variation or variability in the response variable y into two different components. The first component is the explained variability by our model. And the second component is the variation in y that cannot be explained by our model. Variation is usually measured using a sum of squares. So the total variability in y is denoted as SST, with SS standing for sum of squares and T for total. SSR stands for sum of squares in our regression model, R. And SSE for the sum of squares of errors. So the relationship between these three terms can be written as SST equals to SSR plus SSE. Most software will output a separate table for ANOVA analysis. The top table is the ANOVA gap from Excel. The ANOVA tables from different software may look slightly different, with the columns may be placed at different places, but they should all contain the essential information. It is critical to become familiar with the presentation of the ANOVA tables for the particular software you are using. In our ANOVA table, we have sources of variation in the first column. The degrees of freedom of each source is in the second column, followed by their respective sum of squares, mean squares, and F-statistic, or F-ratio, and the p-value in the very last column. Let's talk about these numbers in more detail next. First, there are three sources of variation. Total. That's the total variation in the response variable, or time in our example. So that is represented using SST. Model. Model refers to the variation of a regression model or the explained variation by our model. So it is SSR. Remember, R is for the regression. And error. Error refers to the variation that is unexplained by the model. So it is SSE. Next, for degrees of freedom. Degrees of freedom for total is n minus 1, so that's sample size minus 1. For our example, that's 300 minus 1, so that's why you see 299 here. The degrees of freedom for model is always k. K is the number of independent variable x used in the regression model. For our tracking example, that is 1, because we only used miles to predict time. So we should always have 1 here for simple linear regression model. The degrees of freedom for error, that is this cell, is the difference between the degrees of freedom of total and the degrees of freedom of model. So it is n minus 1 minus k, as you can see here as well. The mean square column is just a ratio between sum of squares and the degrees of freedom column. For example, MSR, mean square of regression, R from SSR here, it is just a ratio between SSR and k. Mean square of error, MSE, it is just SSE with the corresponding degrees of freedom, n minus k minus 1. We don't need to calculate the mean square for the total, so I will just leave this one out. Please be sure to check these numbers using the numbers shown in the Excel stat output. The most important number in this entire table is probably the F stat, also known as F ratio by some other software. It is because this number is indeed a ratio between MSR and MSE, as you can see here. Dividing MSR by MSE, we will be able to obtain the F-test statistic of 276. You can try using 539 divided by 1.949. It should give you 276.605. The very last number is the p-value associated with this f-stat. F-stat is a distribution that takes two sets of degrees of freedom. A little different from t-distribution and chi-square distributions, those only take 1 degree of freedom. Remember, f-stat is actually a ratio. It's a ratio between those two numbers. So the two sets of degrees of freedom are called the numerator degree of freedom and denominator degrees of freedom, respectively. And they are k and n minus k minus 1, as we have discussed earlier. Hooray! We have finally finished explaining all the numbers in this table. Let's take a look how we can use this table, or more specifically, the f-stat, to answer whether this regression model is a good model or not. For ANOVA analysis, we're carrying a hypothesis test, in particular, an F-test, to see whether the model is useful or not. The null hypothesis is the model is useless, and the alternative hypothesis is the model is not completely useless, or alternatively, that means the model is somewhat useful. The test statistic is f-stat, and the p-value would be able to help us to determine whether this model is useful or not. If the model is very small, we reject the null and claim the model is useful. If the p-value is large, we fail to reject the null and conclude the model is useless. Let's take a look at ANOVA output from our example. The test statistic is an F ratio of 276.605. The degrees of freedom, there are two sets of them. So the numerator degrees of freedom is 1, and the denominator degrees of freedom is 298. With these numbers, we can calculate the p-value using Excel function f.dist, and that will be 0. In many cases, the p-value is included in the software output, as you can see here. The p-value is extremely small in the Excel stat output. Because the p-value is extremely small, so we reject the null, and we take the alternative. That means we conclude our model is not completely useful, or it is useful. So that's great, isn't it? The second model diagnostic is R-squared. R-squared is a very important number for linear regression. It's also known as the coefficient of determination. It can be calculated using the ratio between SSR and SST. Remember, SSR is the part of variation in Y that can be explained by our model. SSR divided by SST is actually the proportion of explained variation by the regression model. This number is between 0 and 1. If R-squared is close to 1, say 0.95, that means 95% of the variation can actually be explained by our model, which says the model is a very good model. We generally consider a model is good if the R-square is more than 70%, but this threshold varies across different fields. The R-square is usually given in the software output. Depends on the software used. This table may be called the goodness of fit table. For our example, the R-square is 0.481, indicating the model is decent, but I wouldn't say it's a very good model. You can also double-check this R-square using SSR divided by SST. And if you do that, it should be quite close to 0.481 as well. When we were using the first ANOVA approach, we we arrived at the conclusion that the model is not completely useless. And when we used the R-squared approach, we learned that this is only a decent model. It's actually not uncommon to arrive at different conclusions using different model diagnostics approaches. By taking a ANOVA analysis and looking at the R-squared, I think we can say that using miles alone to model time is a decent model, but probably not a very strong model given the R-squared is only about 48%. There are a bunch of other numbers that are also given in the goodness of fit table. For example, RMSE, MAPE, and AIC. They are mostly metrics to assess how well the model fits the data. We will not talk about them in this video. The adjusted R-square is particularly useful for multiple linear regression as discussed in a separate video that's linked in the upper right corner of this screen. From the definition of R-square, we can write 48.1% of the variability in travel time can be explained by miles traveled. That means 51.9% of the variability in the travel time remains unexplained. The manager of this trucking company should consider adding one or more X to the model to explain more variability in the travel time. And this will be done in our multiple linear regression videos later. Another model diagnostic method is using the standard error of estimate. The standard error of estimate measures the spread of data points around the fitted line. A model is considered to be good if all points are quite close to the fitted line, meaning the spread is small, so the standard error of estimate is also small. We prefer models with smaller standard error of estimate. The standard error of estimate can be calculated using square root of MSE. In the Excel stat output, you probably remember MSE was also given in the ANOVA table, and again in the goodness of fit table. It is 1.949. When we take the square root of 1.949, we were able to get 1.396, and this is a standard error of estimate. From the absolute sense, 1.396 is a somewhat small number, but it would be difficult to tell whether this is small enough without doing an actual statistical test. We do not have a clear threshold for this metric. So this is one drawback of using standard error of estimate. The very last model evaluation tool is residual analysis. The residuals are just the difference between the actual observations and estimates from our model. We would visually examine the residuals or the standardized residuals to detect any violations of the assumptions. There are four model assumptions. They can be summarized using four letters, L, I, N, E, line. Linearity refers to the relationship between X and Y is linear. Independence of errors refers to the errors are independent of one another. And normality of errors, the errors around regression line is normally distributed at each value of x. Equal variance, homoscedasticity, the variation around the regression line must be constant for all values of x. We have already checked the first linearity assumption using the scatter plots between each x and y. The remaining three will be checked using residual plots. Let's take a look at the independence of errors assumption. For this assumption, we will assume the errors are independent of each other. So first, we will have to produce residual plots. The residual plots can be easily produced using ExcelStat or other software. In ExcelStat, modeling data, linear regression. Residual plots are standard output from ExcelStat whenever we run linear regression. What to expect if this assumption is satisfied? If errors are indeed independent of each other, the residuals should look like randomly distributed. And we do not observe any clear pattern in this residual plots. From the residual plots here, we do not observe any clear pattern. Thus, it looks like the independence assumption is valid here. These are some examples when the independence assumption is not valid. For example, in the first one, the residues are not independent of each other because there are runs of positive residues followed by runs of negative residues. On the second plot, we can also see that there is some kind of oscillating behavior of the residues around zero. So it is always a positive residue followed by a negative residue. Positive, negative, positive, negative. The next assumption is normality of errors. We will assume the random errors to be normally distributed. What to expect if this assumption is satisfied? We are going to use the empirical rule to test this assumption. The empirical rule says that about 68% of the points should be fall with The empirical says that about 68% of the residual points should fall anywhere between plus minus 1. 95% of the points should be plus minus 2, and we do not expect to see any residues fall outside a negative 3 or positive 3. By looking at our residual plots, it looks like the normality assumption is also valid. So this is a positive 3, and this is negative 3. So we shouldn't see any points beyond that. And roughly speaking, about 95% of the points should be between plus minus 2. And 2/3 of the observations should be between plus minus 1. The last assumption is equal variance, also known as a homoscedasticity. We will assume the error variance to be constant for all values of x and estimated y. What to expect if this assumption is satisfied? Residues should scatter around the zero line with constant spread, so the variance should stay about the same across the entire residual plot, regardless of whether the horizontal axis is x miles or estimated y predicted time. When the constant variance assumption is not satisfied, we have a condition known as a heteroscedasticity. To detect whether we have a constant variance, all we need to do is plot the residues against the predicted y, against the actual y, and also against each independent variable x. Over here, I plot a toy example on this slide. The constant variance is not satisfied as the residual spread clearly increases with estimated y. So we do not have homoscedasticity for this toy example. In conclusion, all four model assumptions are valid for our tracking example. This concludes our model diagnostic section of this slide and also concludes the simple linear regression analysis. I will see you again in our next video where we talked about a more complicated version of linear regression, the multiple linear regression analysis.